laughing up here because I gave Ricky the wrong information. I'm sorry. It's not Second Peter. Ray and I are laughing at each other going, man, that's a hard verse to preach on. Ray goes, I don't want to preach on that. I go, I don't either.
We'll let Myron do it.
There you go.
The text that we're actually supposed to look at is 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 8. Give me the blank side first, and then can I get you to come up and turn it around? Second Peter. No, I'm sorry. So trying to figure out what I'm going to say about those verses he just read. First Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 8. I think this will be a little easier to understand. Coming to him, him is capitalized, so you're talking about Jesus. Coming to him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God, and what?
Precious.
You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the Scripture. Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. And he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore, to you who believe, he is what? Now, out of the verses I've read, how many times has this word precious been used? That's the third time, right? I think they're trying to tell you something about Jesus and about who he is, what he is, and who he should be to us. Amen. He is precious. But to those who are disobedient, it is written that the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. And a stone of what? Stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble being disobedient to the word to which they also were what? They were appointed. What does that mean? That those who stumble and are disobedient were also appointed to the word. Ray mentioned this earlier in a Sabbath school class. When Christ reconciled the world to God the Father, who did he reconcile? All. Everybody. And that when it comes to the righteous and the wicked, God loves them the same. And that all have been called to obedience in Christ, to obedience to his word, right? Righteous, wicked, we have been called, and this is why we take the gospel to the world, right? This is why we are entrusted with this great commission to take the wicked and bring them into a righteous relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Is that right? So, everyone is on a level playing field. And this is why the Bible says God is no respecter of persons. Understand? This is why God does not look at the righteous and owe them anything that they can say to him, I follow you, you owe me this. Nor can the wicked say, why did you do this to me? Right? God loves everyone. And he wants to save everyone. But the choice is ours to make. Is that right? Mm-hmm. We have that freedom to choose whether we will submit and accept his gift or whether we'll reject it. Now let me ask you a question. Those who have already decided in their life that they want nothing to do with God, do you think they'll be happy in heaven?
No.
Do you think they'll be happy in a place that is holy?
No.
That is undefiled? What's the only thing that you're told you can take to heaven?
Character.
So, if you have a character that has not been touched by Christ, cleaned up by Christ, and made new by Christ, do you think your character that you're taking there will fit in? So do you understand why God in his love, in his mercy, when he makes the final choice of judgment, will allow those who will be lost to be lost because of the decisions they have made? You understand that? it's a little easier to understand why there's going to be a judgment and why some will make it and some won't. It's not that God is arbitrary, it's not that God loves some and hates others, but it's because of the choices we make, the decisions we make, and who will we decide to follow.
Am I going to have problems with that marker, or will it work for me?
Does
it work for you?
Yes.
Okay, then it'll work for you.
But I brought two just in case.
I want to give you a little illustration today about life on this earth and your relationship with God and what God does in this work and plan of salvation. Okay? This is the beginning of your life. This is when you were born, right? This is the end of your life when you will die. And everything here to here is in between, right? That's life. That's not what God intended. This is a straight line, correct? Point A, point B. Well, this is me, so this is why God does all the writing on the board. Now listen, this is your life before you know Christ. You live in this world, you try to make it in this world, and you go from this point to this point, and everything in between is wrapped up around you and how you live in this world, right? This is what happened after the fall. We became self-centered creatures that we look out for ourselves, right? What God intended is a life that is like this. Excuse that, that is bad, but that's the best I can do. Don't worry about that little thing. It's a circle. It's a peach. Okay. It's a circle. Okay? Now, let me make sure I can do this. That meat tastes good. Alright. This is where your life starts. This is where your life ends. Is that circle complete?
No.
No. You know why? Because this little bridge right here, this gap, is sin. Okay? And now, because of this sin, this is the life that you live outside of Christ. Point A, point B. Is that horizontal, or is that S horizontal, right?
Yeah.
Horizontal. It's just a flat line going from one point to the other. It's because of this sin, something needed to happen to bring this back to full circle, because here is God. This is your life, right? Who wants to live in you, work through you, and make you his child? God, right? So shouldn't your life from beginning to end revolve around God? But because of this sin, there's that gap there. And the more you give in to this sin, the straighter this line becomes. And the farther you become from God. You understand what I'm saying? Does that make sense to you? So God sent Jesus Christ into this world to bridge that gap. And God promised you, if you accept Jesus Christ, he will create you brand new, right? So he takes your life and he brings it back into a full, complete circle. And when you sin in this life, you get little gaps in this circle. Right? Ray hit on this in his class as well. The bridging of this gap was justification. The living of this life, bringing back full circle, is sanctification. Justification goes with you all the days of your life, because you will never have sanctification without justification. Yeah. And you will never have justification without sanctification. Okay? So both of them come together. When you get these little gaps, You know, we studied this a little bit last week in my class. Why did Jesus institute foot washing? What did he say? When he girded himself in the upper room, his disciples were arguing who was going to be the greatest out of them, right? At that Passover dinner, Jesus told two of his disciples, go to this man, tell him that the master needs use of the room, and he'll set it up for you. The man set the room up. You had a table that was this way and that way, a horseshoe. You had the master, Jesus, sitting here in the middle, and then the disciples, both sides. You had the greatest disciple on the one side, the second greatest on the other side of Jesus, correct? And then the order they went all the way down that table. Now, who wanted to be the greatest? Peter. But yet, John and his brother wanted to be the greatest too, because they had their mother go to Jesus and say, do me a favor. Grant this one request. Okay? So in that upper room, Jesus girds himself and he gets a basin of water, because these guys, in their self-centeredness and not understanding what was happening, forgot to get the person to wash the feet. Right? And now they knew this. And you know that uncomfortable feeling where I'm looking at you, Ray, you're looking at Ricky, Ricky's looking at Donald, and Donald's looking back at me, we're all, you know what I'm saying? Jesus stands up, because he knew what needed to be done. And he takes the towel and the basin, and he girds himself. And he goes to Peter. What does Peter say to him?
No.
Lord, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus said to Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you have no place with me. And what did Jesus say? And this is the answer to this question. Why do we have foot washing? Because Jesus said, he who has had a bath is clean and only needs to have his feet washed. What's the bath that Jesus was talking about?
Baptism.
If you have been baptized, then you only need to have your feet washed, and the rest of you is clean. As you walk through this world, as the man in the video that we watched, what's that series called? In the Footsteps of Jesus? Tracing the Footsteps of Jesus? He says, as you walk through this life, you step in stuff. Right? I thought he put it very well. So you step in stuff. 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 Justification, sanctification. The foot washing process comes in. You partake of communion. And guess what? You have been cleansed, and all that is washed away. If you never accept Jesus Christ, if you never take Him as your Lord and Savior, this is the life you have. You live, and you will die, and all you'll have to show for it is what you did between here and here. And when you get to that point, the next thing you face is God and His judgment. Are you prepared for that? Now, I have much more respect for those people who just say, I don't want nothing to do with God, because you know where they stand. The ones that I fear are the ones who think that they're in a good relationship with Jesus Christ. And yet, when it comes to that day, there will be a group where Jesus says, depart from me, I never knew you. Then there's a whole other class who come into the church who worship a God of their own image. They come in not to worship with you, but to change you. And to bring your service in line to their theology. Okay? That's what the scribes and the Pharisees did. You will worship God as I did. they have this life here when they think they have this life here. If in this walk with God, you give up that connection with Jesus Christ, and this connection is broken, why does it only work for a little bit? This circle starts to straighten out. Okay? And you who thought you were here have become wavy down here, end up being this thing. Question is, where are you at on that board? Is your faith real? Is your walk real? Is your connection with Christ real? How do you know whether it's real or not? That's not rhetorical, but I'm hoping somebody will have some feedback. Because if you can't answer that, you guys have no assurance in your walk with Christ.
Because you have a relationship. You see changes.
And that's what this is based on. Relationship. And if the relationship is real, you're going to have a change in your life. Is that right? How did Jesus say you will know his disciples?
By their love.
By their love. Okay, is that the only thing he said? By their love, by their actions. How are you actually, this is the only time the Bible gives you the right to actually judge, but the other word is a better word than judge is inspect. And that is, how are you to know his disciples? By the something they bear. By the fruit they bear, right? So we're not called as judges, but we are called as fruit inspectors, right? But I don't want you to key in on that inspection part. What I want you to key in on is the fruit part. And I say all this to you to let you know that justification, sanctification, a relationship with God through Jesus Christ will bring you to full circle with Him. And that will produce fruit that can be seen by the world. Is that right? Jesus said, let your light so shine before men that they glorify your Father in heaven. Right? He said many other things concerning your fruit, concerning your obedience to Him and how that will translate to the world that you come in contact with. Right?
Yeah, right? Because real fruit attracts bugs in this world.
So how do you know that your relationship with God is real? And it is because of the changes that take place in your life. If you've been a Christian for 5 years or less, is your life, are you the same person you were today as you were 5 years ago?
No.
Hence, the Spirit is working in you. Your relationship is real, right? If you've been a Christian for 20 years, are you the same person you were 20 years ago?
No.
Now, what I'm talking about is what used to draw you away from God, what used to be very tempting to you, still hold that same power over you today? Is there change? If you see change, then that means the Spirit is working in you. You have this relationship. You know what I'm saying? And hence, your relationship is real. And it's based on the rock and not based in sand. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Now, understand this. This isn't about what you do. Because there are those who will think, well, you know, I should be doing this, and I don't see that in my life. And, you know, this person over here talks about doing this and doing that and doing that. I don't do any of that stuff. Are you that person?
No.
Has God called you for a specific purpose?
Yes.
You will never know that purpose until you have this relationship with God. How many like to go door-to-door evangelizing? Cold knocking on doors and having those people open the door and then you have to talk to them. How many like that? Raise your hand. I love that lesson. See, because there are people who God made for that. I'm not one of those people. I don't enjoy that. It scares me. I can do it, because I've been trained to do it, but I don't like it. And so what I figured out is that's not what my calling is. Right? And so I don't feel guilty that I don't do that, because I'm not, I don't like doing that. I do know what God has gifted me for, and that is what I focus on. You know what I'm saying? And I'm very comfortable in doing that. But then you go, well, you know, everybody talks about you have to step out of your comfort zone. You can either be allow yourself to be driven nuts, or you find your foundation in Christ. He doesn't call you to do everything. He doesn't call you to do everything. Okay? What He has gifted you for is what He's called you to do. And that's what He expects from you. Are you using those talents for what God wants you to do? Okay? Can you turn that board around? Maybe back it up.
Yeah.
This is like a car. Yeah. 3-point turn?
More like a truck.
One, two, three.
There we go.
Okay, so in set,
First
Peter. Donald put down here for us that Christ is a sure foundation. Verse 4 says, to whom coming as unto a living stone. Do you know what that means? Why would they use the word a living stone? Are stones alive? So what is the meaning and the purpose of this term living stone? Because you don't just find it here in Peter.
We're living sacrifice.
A living sacrifice?
Our lives should be.
Okay. But why does it actually use the word living stone? There's a meaning behind that. Right.
Deuteronomy 32:4. He is the rock. His work is perfect, for all His ways are judgment, a God of truth, without iniquity, just and right is He.
Don't change it.
So a rock is something that is solid, right? And would make a good foundation, right? And if you were to make a cornerstone, you know what a cornerstone is? The whole building rests on that cornerstone.
Unmovable.
Now, if you were to take the lime rock here in Florida, would that make a good cornerstone?
No.
Right? So you want to make sure that the stone that you're building upon is strong, is sure, and will not shift. Right? And this is why, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. Who is Peter talking about here? Who is this living stone? It is Jesus. Jesus is this cornerstone. He is the sure foundation that the church is built on and that the gates of hell cannot overcome.
Amen.
Right? So, He is this living stone, disallowed indeed of men, meaning that the world will reject Him, but His sheep who hear His voice, know His voice, and will what? Follow Him. Okay? And brothers and sisters, if you build upon this living stone of Jesus Christ, you will never be shaken.
Amen.
To whom coming is unto a living stone, disallowed of men, but chosen of God. Listen, did Jesus think all this stuff up Himself? Was this plan, did it originate from Him? I'm talking as a man now, okay? This is something from God the Father Himself. And when He sees Jesus Christ is precious. But it's not just talking about Jesus Christ there. What is actually precious is those who are coming to Jesus as living stones.
Amen.
You guys get that?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay? Jesus is precious, but you are precious in the sight of God, which is why he did everything he did for your salvation. There is nothing more that he could have done that he has not done already.
Amen.
You also, if Jesus is a living stone, then what are we? Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spirit. Don't you love? Don't you think that's like bad English? Are built up a spiritual house.
Because we all form a house, one house, not many houses.
I've read that. It's like, what are you trying? Because I've got bad English. And I would write that. But he was trying to say something there, and you have to look and say, what is he actually trying to say? What do you think a spiritual house is? A church? Is that what this is talking about? Is this talking about the church?
No.
Let me ask you a question. Is this the temple?
No.
Or is this the temple? And that is the spiritual house that is being built up. But now you look and you read the writings of Paul, when Paul says that the body of Christ is made up of many what? Many members, right? And so you and you and everybody back there, when we come together, each one a spiritual house, we come together and we form the body of Christ. Hence we become one.